Good afternoon, Dell fans, and welcome back to fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada. We're here coming to the close of our second day of 3 days of coverage here at Dell Tech World. My name is Savannah Peterson, bringing you all the latest and greatest with Dave Vellante this week. Dave, I think this afternoon's lineup is my favorite so far at the show.
Deep into day two here, Savannah.
Yeah, deep into day two, all the smart people and a lot of smart women back to back.
Love
Yvonne,
it.
And now JJ, welcome back to the show. So nice to have you.
Hi, thanks for having me. Great to be here.
Good to see you again.
Always a pleasure. We had such a blast interviewing you last year. It feels like the whole world has changed in the last 12 months. Talk to us a little bit about what you've been working on and the momentum you're seeing.
Sure, well, it has been a great 2 days here at Dell Technologies World, and like we've been talking about, enterprise AI is starting to grow and scale with customers moving from experimentation to implementation. You know, what I do in corporate affairs is really think a lot about brand and reputation. How do customers overcome the risks and obstacles they face alongside the massive AI opportunity? And so what we're really working on is, of course, supporting our core business and helping to create and grow the enterprise, both public and private sector marketplace, supporting our tier two CSP customers, which we saw so many great customers on stage over the last 2 days.
So many customers.
CoreWeave, to Lowe's and JP Morgan Chase and USAA and then our partner Cohere. Obviously we support the company in all of those efforts, but we also work really closely with our government affairs team, our chief AI officer, Doug Schmidt, our head of IT, our executive team on AI advocacy and how we think about AI and trust, energy and AI, sovereign AI, the policies that we need to put in place to influence government, skilling, and what are the skills of the future to prepare the current and future workforce. So there's so many elements to making the AI era real. And so that's some of what I do every day on top of supporting the commercial endeavors of the company.
I think, so you mentioned a couple of those customer case studies that you had on stage. You even had Norby, the little robot, which is cute. Love that one. You've also got some AI-driven customer success stories that you're able to share with us today.
Oh, well, I mean, I know we've been showcasing customer stories on the stages over the last 2 days, and I was just blown away with what JP Morgan and Lowe's and USAA shared in terms of how advanced they are. You know, part of my remit is also sustainability, to see that come through in their storytelling and what JP Morgan is doing with its headquarters and how they're building for a sustainable future for both business and society is really impressive. You know, we also have a lot of public sector customers here with us this week and nonprofits that are putting AI to work with Dell's help. So we're working with Scripps at UC San Diego. We have donated an AI factory to them to really work hand in hand on making the data center grid aware. How can you schedule workloads when electricity is more available or cheaper? You can do everything you need to do with your data and for your business at a lower cost with lower emissions. And so they have been able to drive down their energy costs, down their emissions, and up their productivity for their studying of coral reefs and how they're helping to preserve this ecosystem around the world. So that's one great example.
I love that one. I did not know that narrative.
Yeah. And they're here in the show floor somewhere, so go check it out.
Yeah, neat.
Our nonprofit partner, Hopeworks, out of Philadelphia, is also working with us. They have another AI factory, which is also available through our customer solution centers, where they're putting AI assistants to work to train young adults to ready them for the workforce of the future. And so it is an AI assistant that you can engage with in any language to really prepare your soft skills, which are still so critical for landing a good, high-paying job.
You and I talked in February, I think I was down in Austin, and you know, with all the DEI backlash, I said, you know, you haven't blinked on your sustainability goals, and what dawned on me, because you were never in it for virtue signaling, you were in it because it's good business. Explain to the audience why sustainability is good business.
Well, I mean, think about it. To be a sustainable business, first and foremost, you have to be financially sound. Mm. But you also need to make sure you're preparing for the future from an environmental sustainability standpoint as well. I mean, we talked about it in our press conference today, and Michael said, you know, circularity and recycling or taking back old equipment when we sell new equipment. We've been doing this for, you know, as long as I've worked here, 25 years almost, and it is really core because what we make, when you upgrade, we need to help you do something responsible with that unit, and we need all the parts.
Yeah.
From within that unit or a server or a storage array, because we want to turn trash into treasure. Guess what it does? It lowers costs, it preserves the environment, it has positive impact when you're dealing with things like trade and tariffs. And so when we can put recycled conflict minerals back into our systems versus virgin mining, that has also positive human rights impact as well. And so companies need to think about their core values and their purpose and how they can drive sustainable outcomes for their business, their customers, and the broader community at large.
Can you reuse rare earth
Yeah, we have
metals?
You can.
We have a 50% recycled, we have 50% recycled cobalt in some of our Latitude batteries. We were the first to do that.
There's a bunch of recycled magnesium in this device
right
in front of us.
So
that's
huge,
right.
Given, of course, you know,
it's
today's
a huge thing. Yeah. And this is why, and a lot of these efforts are part of Project Luna, correct? Is that what you all call it?
Well, it was a concept from several years ago, and it was never going to sell as an actual product, but we took elements of it that we could manufacture at scale and deliver to our customers, and that's what we're doing. And then The UC San Diego example I gave, that one has a concept name as well, Concept Astro, and that isn't productized yet. How do you make the data center grid aware? But we're working on, can we productize it, and what elements might we learn from that we can make available to customers at scale, just like what we did with Luna, pushing the boundaries of what's possible.
Say more about Concept Astro.
Well, the idea is, how do you take an AI factory and not just make the AI factory itself more efficient? So you've heard a ton about Dell's leadership in modern data center efficiency, the best performance per watt of anybody in the market. What we're doing with liquid cooling innovation, we now have the brand name PowerCool, which we announced in Michael's keynote yesterday. Going beyond that, how can you not just make the hardware and, you know, the optimized software more efficient, but schedule your software at the workload level. How do you run it when energy is more available and cheaper? So if you have a super intensive workload, run it, you can schedule it through agentic AI to run when the energy is available, and then your less intensive workloads can run at higher peak times. And so, can we get smart enough at scale to operate our data centers at the workload level, which is going to have real benefit to energy availability for our customers?
Well, and you're doing this all the way from the data center to the edge here, and these devices are also efficient. These AI PCs are able to do the exact same thing here on the edge where all of our data is. It's pretty exciting.
Well, I mean, you heard all about the Dell Pro Max today from Sam Bird, and the power of a data center essentially at your fingertips, and how do you offload the AI small language models or inferencing onto a laptop or a workstation and take that burden off of the data center? That's going to be good for the environment as well, which is a side benefit to what developers actually want.
Client server's back.
I know.
Yeah.
In a different way, but it's big.
I think
what is important for everybody to remember is we innovate based on what our customers demand, what they need. And building sustainability into our innovation engine is what our customers want us to do.
Yeah, how would you rank the concern of energy efficiency, for example, in the sustainability stack to the other concerns that some of your customers have when they come, or things they need, other demands, I should say?
Energy availability and cost, especially in markets like Europe where energy is very expensive, it's a huge concern. But they're thinking about energy diversification, energy availability, cost, You've heard a lot in the last 2 days about underutilization in data centers of today, much less greenfield and what's coming, and so we need to help our customers make sure they're not over-provisioning or where they can consolidate, do that. How do we make sure that all kinds of energy are available? And so it is a big issue, but they're not thinking about it always from an altruistic point of view. I mean, this is what they need to do to run their business and get ahead, but they want to do it the right way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like we were saying, it's good business, and capacity planning has become a thing again.
Well, you know, right?
And because Jeff talk about, you know, the incremental impact and how many more tokens, and that's all energy, and so how do you plan for that?
Yeah.
You know, you can't just pick a number and double it.
Right. Right. Well, and you got to be mindful. You know, I love your point. It's not just about the good vibes. In the same way a diverse team produces better results and higher ROI, a sustainable business will save you money and achieve you bigger results. Talk to me a little bit more about the customer conversations that you have around these when they're sharing these requests with you, or you're talking to the people about saving the coral reefs. I'm not going to get over that. I'm going to bring that up 10 different times on the show. That is so cool. I love snorkeling, and that's very, you're speaking my language. But what's the feedback loop like? How do you know what to do?
Sure. So, you know, we have customer RFPs that we answer every day. We have customer questionnaires from existing customers. Sustainability is in 95% of our RFPs today. We have customer boards and partner advisory boards. I spent an hour and a half with our partners yesterday in ways we can best partner to deliver more asset recovery services to our joint customers, as an example. So we have that 360 feedback loop. In fact, just this morning I shared our Q1 insights from our sustainability RFP, so the product groups can get that and factor it into how they're thinking about longer term sustainable roadmap decisions that they need to make. And so I think with AI and agentic AI coming, we're going to be able to combine so many sources of insights from our trusted analysts as well to be able to package them up in a way that I think is so much easier for our sales teams, our product teams, to make decisions. It's harder than it needs to be right now, but with the help of technology, this data and these insights are going to be so much easier to act on because we'll be able to integrate them in a way we never have before.
Absolutely, you just sparked a little light bulb moment for me, JJ. And I'm wondering, I'm going to ask this as a question, but maybe an observation. You know, the negative conversation around AI is a lot around cost and power and capacity as we scale. The reality is, if I'm hearing you right and putting the pieces together, AI might actually make us a more sustainable world in general. We could be more energy efficient across the board.
Yeah, I mean, we are working on, you know, AI for green. And so not just how do you make AI infrastructure more efficient, but what problems, big problems, can AI solve? And you can apply them to healthcare and farming and all kinds of areas that are desperately needing this scale to solve these problems. I mean, my son starts medical school in August, and a lot of people are like, well, what about AI? How is it going to impact the medical field? And he wants to do research and cure disease. Well, maybe he will actually be able to do that in his lifetime.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, we last night we had Memorial Sloan Kettering on, and I love Jess. She's such a firecracker, just a brilliant person. But they are literally, I mean, they just had 100% success rate with this clinical trial for rectal cancer. 100% success rate.
Yeah,
first
it's incredible.
It's really incredible. I mean, I think the when your son's a resident coming out on the other side of that, his experience or researcher, whatever pathway he chooses, we're not pigeonholing him, but there will be such a different landscape of possibility. He'll be able to achieve things faster and really have even greater impacts.
Well, you know, AI skilling is another big topic, and how do we ensure that we have the workforce of the future? And so you're even seeing a recent executive order coming out of the White House in late April around what we need to do to upskill America at the K-12 level and as students try to go enter the workforce. And so what training and education and skill building do we need to provide to the students and to the teachers? How can public and private sector partner? And so, you know, we are driving a lot of initiatives inside our company with our partners and in the communities that we want to share, so together we can hopefully hopefully scale what it is society needs to fully participate.
That upskilling piece is so important.
I was going to ask a follow-up on that. How did you deal with the upskilling internally?
So we have a learning development arm within our company, and we started just with 101. So we had a four-part AI skilling series where we just educated our team members on our AI strategy, what AI is, and all the things that they can start to engage in. And we had a near 100% participation in that. John Rose has just rolled out agentic AI training. Michael talked about it today around leadership imperative, which is something when we have a big tectonic change or transformation in our company, we start at the most senior level and we do a train the trainer model. Like I did a class of 50 people where we talked about our AI strategy and what it is each team member needs to do to fully participate. So it's a multi-pronged change management approach because we need every single person at Dell all in on this AI journey, but we've got to train people. That's kind of at the bigger general level, but then all the way down to training on the tools. So we are content creators in marketing, and so we use a different AI tool than maybe the developer uses or the salesperson uses. So we had to train people, and we have to pay for that and the licenses we need. We also need better workflow so that the AI and the AI created content can eventually connect to the workflow so it can be automated with less people putty, if you will. So, and it's going to be an ongoing journey because it's going to constantly change. So this idea of always on learning, no matter what age you are or what level in your career you are, is going to be so important.
Stay
Investing
curious.
Investing in people through training, it'll always pay it for itself eventually.
And that's right.
And just stay curious, man. I think that's the curiosity quotient, most important of the EQ, IQ, CQ, whatever it might be. I think that's one of the metrics, I'm going to write a piece on it, one of the metrics of how successful companies will be, because
that's right.
It's kind of cool, we're coming back, Yvonne was talking about Sunday school and how she's teaching little kids and how they're showing her all the neat things that they're doing with AI, and I love this because to your whole full circle moment, it's the teach the teachers and bring that down, and then also these new minds that are rising up, these AI natives, are going to be teaching us a lot. I'm sure we're going to learn a lot from them. Wow, okay, this is so fun to think about. JJ, final question for you.
Sure.
When we're hanging out at Dell Tech World 2026, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say today?
Oh gosh, well I hope that elements of Concept Astro are real. And that we can really make the data center grid aware.
Yeah.
So that we can start to really add even more value and greater savings for businesses and the planet.
Well, we cannot wait to continue to tell that story. Maybe we can even bring some of them up here and have that dialogue. I'm just pumped.
Sounds
I'm going to have to dig into that. JJ, it's always such a joy to
thank
have you on
you.
This show. We appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thanks, JJ.
Yeah, and thank you, Dave. And thank all of you for tuning in to our 3 days of live coverage here in beautiful Las Vegas, Nevada. We're at Dell Tech World. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.